continue from that point today. So what we had seen that in a rotating frame, the centrifugal force is given by the relation. M omega square r, r cap, where r is the perpendicular distance from the axis of rotation. M is of course mass of the body, and omega is the angular velocity or the angular speed of the rotating frame. So let's understand an interesting type of question based on this concept today. So we have this kind of situation next. There is an open hemispherical ball like this. Is rotating about this axis with an angular velocity omega naught, has a radius r. So this inner surface is smooth. So open hemispherical hole is rotating at constant angular speed omega naught as shown. The radius of the hole is equal to 10 meters. And acceleration due to gravity is 10 meters per second square. Now what we observe is that there's a particle lying on the inner surface of the ball inside at a position such that this theta, so a particle P is observed to be at rest with respect to the ball's surface, which is a smooth surface. At theta equal to 37 degrees with respect to the vertical. So first of all, make the particle's free body diagram in the ball's frame. In the frame of the ball, with respect to the ball, that is, what is, we have to make the free body diagram of the particle. Okay, and find omega naught in radians per second. How much is the angular speed omega naught? So that this condition is satisfied, that the particle is at rest with respect to the ball. Okay, given that we know theta is 37 degrees, G is 10 meters per second square, and the radius of the surface is capital R. This centrifugal force concept was done in the last lecture, Bhargav. Okay. So I have sent the recording and the notes of the previous lecture on the group. So you can go through that and catch up anything you might have missed out. Okay, so just try to make the free body diagram yourself. We will discuss this question soon. We just want you to understand what kind of forces will be acting on that particle, which is at rest on the ball, which is rotating at angular speed omega naught like this. Okay, so let's understand this free body diagram. Jay, I'll verify the answer for you. So what is happening is, if we are part of the rotating frame, we are in this rotating frame, then for the particle which is over here, the net force in our frame should be zero because it's at rest with respect to the rotating frame. So this particle should be at rest. Now the forces acting on it will be centrifugal force, which will be in this sort of direction, where r will be this distance, the perpendicular distance from the axis of rotation. So this is centrifugal force, which remember is a type of pseudo force that acts in the rotating frame. And of course, apart from that, there will be gravitational force acting vertically downwards, and the normal contact force at the surface is applying on it, which will be pointing radially. Okay, so these are the different forces that will be acting on the body. And under the action of all these forces, the particle or body will be at rest. Okay, now as you can see, this distance is capital R, this radial distance. So small r is actually equal to capital R sine theta, because this is the center of curvature from here to the particle's position. This distance is capital R. So now this perpendicular distance, small r, comes from this formula. So that's why small r is equal to capital R sine theta. Okay. Now about balancing the forces. So you can see that in this free body diagram, drop a vertical over here, this angle is theta. So this component of n becomes n cos theta, and this component of n becomes n sin theta. So n cos theta should balance mg, whereas n sin theta should balance m omega naught square small r. So if we divide these two equations, we have tan theta is equal to omega naught square r by g. So we have tan theta is equal to omega naught square capital R sine theta by g because of this relation. Further, we can see that omega naught will become square root of g by r cos theta. The sine theta will cancel out. So in this particular case, it will be square root of 10 divided by 10 into 0.8, because theta was 37 degrees, R was 10 meters. This should be the angular speed. RF stands for rotating frame. Yeah, Bhargav. RF stands for the fact that we are in the rotating frame. whenever a particle is in a rotating frame, it experiences centrifugal force. Just like we had seen in Newton's laws of motion, a particle in a non-inertial frame experiences pseudo force. Like that, in a rotating frame, a particle experiences centrifugal force. Okay, people, so hope this question is clear to all of you. Okay, next we move on to a very important concept called banking of roads. When we consider a circular track or road with a flat surface, okay, so that means the surface is in a horizontal plane. So the top view would look something like this. Suppose a vehicle is going on this circular track. From the top, you could see the tangential velocity like this. This would be the radial axis. Somewhere here would be the center of curvature. So it would have a centripetal acceleration in this direction. But talking about a flat surface, the side view would look like this. It's a sort of a the surface of the road is flat. So the forces acting on it are normal reaction mg and friction in this sort of direction to provide the centripetal acceleration. So you can see that if it is going at the speed of V0 and R is the radius of curvature of the circular path, then the required amount of friction becomes like this. So as you can see, for a flat surface, the condition becomes now the static friction available is less than equal to mu n. So mv naught square by r should be less than equal to mu h. So v naught should be less than equal to square root of mu g r. This becomes the condition for the vehicle not slip. Okay. So for example, if we have a situation where the radius of the circular path is 40 meters, g is equal to 10 meters per second square, and mu is equal to, let's say, 0.2. Then V naught is less than equal to it allows for a very slow motion or a very slow speed. So comparatively, a vehicle has to move slowly. On the circular track to avoid slipping. So to overcome this problem, we have the concept of banking of the road, or instead of the surface of the road being flat, the surface of the road is curved, or it's at an angle, it's like an inclined surface, like you would have seen in race tracks, etc. So we'll discuss about that next, and we'll see how that banking of the concept, the banking of the road helps in reducing the tendency for this object or tendency of the car to slip as it is negotiating the circular turn. So just note down this example along with this concept of the required friction to prevent slipping on a flat circular track. Okay, so now next let's understand what happens in the case of what is called a banked road, or when the road surface is given an inclination, or it is bent at an angle with respect to the horizontal, so that the vehicle taking the circular track can have a better grip on it and has a lesser tendency to slip. So this is just an example of a numerical situation where you have a 40 meter radius, and if the coefficient of friction is 0.2, then the limiting speed is as low as just about 9 meters per second. Vehicle goes faster than 9 meters per second, or about 8.9 meters per second, it will have a tendency to slip on the surface because of the very high amount of centripetal acceleration that is required. Now we'll see how banking of the road can solve the problem. So next up, circular track or road. The banked surface. So the top view still very much looks the same. The side view. Now the side view is showing that the surface of the road is actually now inclined to the horizontal. So the road is actually like this. Is the circular road like this, on which the vehicle is moving. So in this case, you can see that the forces acting on the vehicle are normal reaction like this and mg like this. And because the road is bent, now normal reaction has a component which is pointing towards the centripetal direction. So normal reaction N has a centripetal component. And if we adjust the banking angle properly, then for a given speed, there is no longer need for friction to act, because the direction of normal reaction is at the same angle theta to the vertical. That the banking angle is. So over here, theta is called the banking angle. When you see the vehicle in the side view, theta is called the banking angle. That is, the road surface is inclined at theta with respect to the horizontal plane. So coming back to the free body diagram below, you can see that now this vehicle has an acceleration, which is the centripetal acceleration like this. It's pointing towards the axis of the circular path, or the center of the circular path. So for an optimized speed V naught, for which the road has been banked, road or circular track has been banked, no friction acts on the tires. Because N cos theta balances MG, whereas N sin theta provides the centripetal acceleration. This happens because the centripetal component of normal reaction provides the necessary centripetal acceleration for the circular. So there's no question of the slipping taking place. Even if there's zero coefficient of friction and the road is perfectly smooth, in this condition, that N sine theta is equal to MV naught square by R and N cos theta is equal to MG, what will happen is that there'll be no tendency to slip, So from these two equations, again, you can see dividing the two equations. We have tan theta is equal to V naught square by R divided by G. So theta is tan inverse of V naught square divided by GR. This becomes the formula for banking angle theta optimized for a speed V naught on a circular track of radius capital R. So what we mean by optimized is that when a vehicle is coming at this speed and the road is banked at this angle, then no friction will be acting on its tires. So what is the meaning of this term optimized? Explain that below. It implies that for a vehicle taking a turn at V equal to V naught on the road with banking angle theta equal to tan inverse of V naught square by GR, no friction acts on the tires because the tires don't have a tendency to slip. So why this happens? Because the centripetal component of normal reaction provides the necessary centripetal acceleration. And no friction times, because there is no tendency to slip. Okay, so this is the concept of banking angle and banking of a road. So I'll just take you through the whole section from the top. So first we'll go back to the unbanked road for a moment, so that now you understand it in context of a banked road also. So understand what is the meaning of this thing, that when a circular track is having a flat surface, that means the surface is horizontal. The surface of the track is on a horizontal plane. That's why the diagram looks like this. The road surface is perpendicular to the direction in which gravity is acting. So in that situation, it is friction which has to provide the centripetal acceleration. So a comparatively large amount of friction is required. Or if the coefficient of friction is known to us, from that we can calculate the maximum speed at which the turn can be taken so that slipping will not occur. Because the maximum friction available to us is mu mg, whereas the required friction becomes centripetal force, which is m into v naught squared by r. So that restricts the value of speed v naught at which you can go to a comparatively lower value. Whereas on the other hand, when the road is banked, this is what is happening. The normal contact force has a centripetal component. So it's not left to friction to prevent slipping. Okay, Bhargav, is it clear now? The non-banked case is also clear. Okay. So now come to the free body diagram and the maths part, the equations part for the bank road. And go through this and make sure you understand how we got the formula tan theta is equal to V naught squared by gr. Now this one is an important formula and we'll be using it throughout solving problems involving banking angle. That for the optimized speed V naught, no friction is required because tan theta is equal to V naught squared by gr. The derivation of that is coming from the lower steps after this section, where we use equation 1 and 2, which I've written, to find the value of theta for that optimized speed V naught. Okay, so hope you've understood this and finished writing down this part. Okay, Bhargav, I'll scroll up. This part? Okay. Just tell me when you finish this, then I'll move further down. Okay, so done with this part also now. let's understand with an example. Yes. So let's say we have this situation, a circular track. Of radius equal to 50 meters is banked such that for a vehicle moving at 36 kilometers per hour, zero friction. Acts on its tires. So first of all, find the banking angle theta. Take g as 10 meters per second square. Now secondly, if the same vehicle takes the turn at let's say 54 kilometers per hour instead, and its mass is 2000 kgs, then find the frictional force acting on its tires, assuming that it does not slip. So the first part of the question is almost formula based. You just apply the formula of banking angle and the concept from above, you'll be able to come up with the value of theta. Just try it out, listeners. Yeah, so don't worry, the lecture is recorded, so I will send you the recording as soon as possible. Okay, and you can go through the recording and the lecture notes and understand the whole lecture, and whatever doubts you have, please note them down and we'll discuss them in the next session. Okay, so let's understand the first part. So what it's saying is that the road is banked such that, you know, the surface of the road is like this, it's at theta with respect to the horizontal. So when you see the side view, vehicle is taking this sort of turn, for a speed of, so the vehicle in this earlier diagram in the top view, the top you are seeing it moving at a speed v naught like this, and it has a centripetal acceleration towards the center of the circular path, which in this diagram the center will be here. So it has this sort of. So now when we consider the situation where for V equal to V naught, friction is zero on the tires. So there should be only two forces acting. Normal reaction acting perpendicular to the plane, and Mg acting vertically downwards. So the direction of normal reaction is like this, the direction of Mg is like this, and there's no friction acting. So as you can see, the condition for friction to be zero on the tires is that N sine theta is equal to the centripetal force. And N cos theta, balance is Mg. Okay, so once you understood these two equations, theta is the banking angle, the road is, you know, at an angle theta, the surface of the road is at an angle theta to the horizontal, the surface of the road is not flat, the surface of the road is bent. Understanding the point, no? So if this is like a three dimensional kind of view, the road surface is like this, it's at an angle theta to the horizontal. Is it clear now? The banking angle, what it is? Harsh? Yeah. So like you must have seen on race car tracks and all that, no? The road is not flat. The road is slightly bent to the horizontal, such that as you go outwards, the road is going up from the ground. And as you go towards the center of curvature, the road is down like that. So that is done for this reason, so that the normal reaction is not pointing vertically up anymore. If the road had been flat, then the normal reaction would have been pointing vertically upwards. So it would not have any centripetal component. But because the road is bent like this, So the normal reaction is now pointing in this direction. So once the normal reaction is pointing in this direction, it has a component which is centripetal, and that is our n sine theta component, and a component which is vertical, which is n cos theta. So that n sine theta helps in countering the centrifugal force, or helps in countering the tendency to slip. So when the vehicle is moving at the optimal speed V naught, for which the road has been banked, there is no friction acting on its tires. Okay. So this is the situation. These are the two equations. And by dividing the two equations, as usual, we get the standard formula. Equation 1 divided by 2 gives us the standard formula which we wrote down, that tan theta is equal to V naught square by Gr. This is the condition for no friction. Condition for optimal speed. Not at which zero friction acts on the tires. So basically, you can just remember this as a formula also. Okay? So the first thing we needed in our problem is to find out theta. So we were given that the optimal speed was 36 kilometers per hour, which is the same thing as 36 into 5 by 18 or 10 meters per second. And the radius of the circular track, I think, was 40 meters, was it? Sorry, 50 meters. And G will take as 10. Okay. So from that, we will get the angle of banking. Therefore, tan theta is equal to 10 meters per second whole square divided by 10 meters per second square into 50 meters. So that will become 1 by 5 or 0.2. So theta is tan inverse of 0.2. This is the banking angle from the data given. This is the banking angle for the given circular track. So basically, what has happened here? Yes, exactly, Bhargav, that's correct. In water slides also, no? Where you're going through a sharp curve like that, the slide is, the surface of the slide is slightly banked so that, you know, your body receives a normal reaction which will provide the necessary centripetal action. Had it been flat, the lack of friction would cause your body to get thrown off from the surface of the slide. Okay, so basically here what is happening, you can think of it like this, that the civil engineer who has constructed the road, he has taken into consideration that, okay, the average speed of a vehicle taking the turn is suppose 36 kilometers per hour, and the radius, he has measured the turning radius to be 50 meters. So he has calculated that what angle he should bank it at so that the average speed vehicle is safe from skidding because no friction is required. So accordingly, he will bank it at tan inverse of 0.2. And I'll just tell you how much that is in degrees. It's not a very large angle. So it's pretty manageable in terms of construction. So 0.2's tan inverse will give us approximately 11.3 degrees. Okay, so this angle theta is bent the road at about 11.3 degrees with respect to the horizontal. So there's a slight curvature or a slight bend of the road. As you can observe from everyday life, wherever there's a sharp bend on a road, especially where it is expected that vehicles will come at high speed, like a race car track or something, there is always a bit of banking angle to protect the cars from skidding. So hope this concept is clear. Okay. Now next, let's see what happens if a car comes at more than the optimal speed. Okay, the optimal speed is 36 kilometers per hour and the road is banked at 11.3 degrees. So something coming at 36 kilometers per hour will not experience any friction on the tires. But something coming at a higher speed, it will have a tendency to skid. So some friction will have to act on its tires. So the second part, for the same track, now we know for that track, the radius is 50 meters, and we just calculated in first part that the banking angle is tan inverse of 0.2 or approximately 11.3 degrees. So for this track only, if a vehicle takes the turn at a larger speed, 54 kilometers per hour, then how much friction acts on its tires? Assuming it doesn't slip. So now what we'll do is to make the calculation easier. We will make the free body diagram of the vehicle. In a rotating frame. So that we don't have to take into consideration centripetal acceleration. Rather, we have to take into consideration centrifugal force. So we'll make the FBD in the rotating frame. So if we take the top view, won't really help us that much. We'll just understand the geometry of the situation from the top. Won't really help us in free body diagram because we won't be able to see so many of the forces. So now we are in this rotating frame. So in our frame, the vehicle will experience centrifugal force outwards, which will be m, in this case, mv square. Sorry, the speed is now v, it is greater than v naught. So mv square by r. So we're acting on it like this. And then there'll be other forces which are acting inwards. We'll see that as you look at the side view. From the side view, we'll understand that. Now, this is the surface of the road, which is banked at an angle theta, we just discussed. And this is the horizontal plane, let's say. This is the banking angle theta, which we've written above. This is now, this is the side view of the vehicle. So now, since we are in the vehicle's frame or in the rotating frame, we will see that instead of centripetal acceleration, we will take into consideration centrifugal force. And that centrifugal force will be like this. This will be centrifugal force. Mv square by r, where if this is the center of curvature, this is our r. This is the radius of the circle of motion. And other than this, the forces acting on the vehicle are gravitational force and normal reaction, which are acting in these sort of directions. Normal reaction acting perpendicular to the plane of the surface, and mg acting vertically downwards. Now what is going to happen is that there is a tendency of the vehicle to slip outwards. So there is a tendency to slip like this. It has a tendency to skid. So what has to come to rescue is friction. So now friction has to act like this to prevent slipping. So this is how friction has to act. So friction F acts. Along the surface, it inverts, radially inverts, to prevent the vehicle from skidding outwards. Okay. So just make sure this free body diagram is clear, and next we will resolve the forces and understand how to calculate the amount of friction. So hope this is clear. Now when we resolve the forces further, it will be easier to understand. So next step, what we'll do is we'll resolve the forces with respect to the inclined surface and its normal. So this is the banked surface of the road, and this is the direction normal to it. So on the particle that is lying here, you can see that the centrifugal force that we considered in the above diagram, that was acting horizontally in the outward direction. So that was our mv squared by r. A gravitational force which was acting vertically downwards. Like this, normal reaction was acting perpendicular to the surface, so that's over here. And now, because there's a tendency to slip up the inclined plane, so friction has to act down the inclined plane to prevent slipping. So this is the free body diagram, and as far as the angles in the free body diagram is concerned, this angle is theta. So here this angle is theta, so this angle is theta. So based on that, now let's resolve these forces in our next diagram. So on resolving the forces, you can see that centrifugal force has these two components, one up the inclined plane and the other normal to the inclined plane. So this is mv squared by r sine theta, where That is, this is mv square by r cos theta. Whereas mg has similarly got two components. Normal to the inclined plane, mg cos theta, and tangential to the inclined plane, mg sin theta. And then the other two forces that we have, which are friction and the normal contact force. So this is another good diagram to understand that what happens is that when V was equal to V naught, that is the optimized speed of 36 kilometers per hour or 10 meters per second, what was happening is that MV naught square by R cos component was balancing mg sin theta, because remember tan theta was equal to v naught square by gr. So therefore there is no tendency to slip. Okay, so that's why no friction acts. But that was the previous case. Okay, now in this case what is happening, our v is greater than v naught. Now here in this situation, V is equal to 54 kilometers per hour, which means V is greater than V naught, greater than 36. Okay, so that means MV square by R, cut to cos component, the one which is acting up the inclined plane, that is dominating over MG sine theta. Okay, so that means there is the tendency to slip up the incline. And up the incline basically means radially outwards. Because what I'm showing is up the incline here. In the whole diagram, remember, the surface is like this. And the road is bending like this. So something that is having a tendency to slip up the incline like this, it has a tendency to go outwards. So it has a tendency to slip radially outwards. So that is why friction has to act. Therefore, friction acts radially inwards or along mg sin theta to prevent slipping. Okay. So that's what's going on in this case. That's how friction is acting. So now comparing the statement with the diagram above, you can see that to prevent slipping in this frame, the body must be at rest because we are in the rotating frame. So with respect to us, the body must be at rest, or the vehicle's free body diagram must be showing zero acceleration. So friction plus mg sin theta together are balancing mv squared by r cos theta. So the amount of friction required will become this quantity, mv squared by r cos theta minus mg sin theta. So in a moment, I'll show you how to calculate this, because we know the value of m given to us was 2000 kgs. The value of v is 54 kilometers per hour. The radius of the track was 50 meters. And theta we calculated earlier was tan inverse of 0.2. So using this over here, we will have to find out the amount of friction. So this is what happens when a road is banked for a certain optimal speed V naught, but a vehicle comes at a larger speed than that. So the vehicle may still not skid. It might still be safe from skidding, but this time some friction will be acting on its tires to save it from skidding. Whereas if the vehicle is coming at the optimal speed V naught, you can see that mv square by r's cos component is balancing mg sin theta. So there is no friction acting on its tires at all, because it does not have a tendency to slip in the first place. So that is the concept of banking angle. that's another aspect of the concept of banking. So just slow down up to here and then we do the final calculation from the values that I've shown on the side. All right, let's complete this calculation now. So first of all, you'll have to convert the speed to meters per second. So 54 into 5 by 18. That's 15 meters per second. So when you substitute here, this will become 2000 into 15 square by 50. Now I'll tell you how to convert tan theta also. See, tan theta is 0.2 or 1 by 5. So you can convert it to sine and cos. So this is square root of 25 plus 1 or 26. So cos theta is 5 by root 26, which is nearly 1. And sine theta is 1 by root 26, which is nearly 1 by 5. So basically you can see what is happening, something interesting over here, that when tan theta is 0.2, it means that theta is a small angle. So for small angle, sine theta is approximately equal to tan theta and cos theta is approximately equal to 1. So that is what is happening. So you can use those values. So cos theta will be approximately equal to 1. And sine theta will be approximately equal to tan theta, which is 1 by 5 or 0.2. So this will become, take 2000 common. So 15 squares, that is 225. Or what we can do is write this as 9 by 2. will be 25 into 9, so 25 and 25 will cancel. Okay, and minus this term will become 2. So you can see it's basically 4.5 minus 2, so that's 0.5. So it will be about 1000 newtons. So what looked like a very difficult calculation, but it reduces to something quite simple, that the friction required on the tires is 1000 newtons. And 1000 newton might seem like a huge amount to you over here, but remember the weight of the vehicle here is very huge. The mass only is 2000 kg. So the weight of the vehicle is 20,000 kg. 20,000 newtons. So compared to that, the amount of friction that we're talking about is only 1000 newton. It's 1/20th of the weight. So it should not be too much of a problem to generate that much friction from the tires. So the vehicle is still going to be quite safe from skidding. But because the speed is greater than the optimal speed, some friction will be acting on its tires to prevent skidding. Whereas had the speed been reduced to 36 instead of 54 kilometers per hour, as you can see, there would be zero friction acting on the tires. Okay, so when you're revising the concept of banking angle, don't just memorize the formula of banking angle, that theta is tan inverse of V0 square by GR. Also understand this particular example we have done, where you are seeing what is happening when a vehicle comes at the optimal speed V0, whereas you're also seeing what is happening when the vehicle is taking the turn at a speed greater than the optimal speed. Even then, there is no skidding because a very minimal amount of friction is required to prevent it from skidding. And for solving this, we are using that small little trick that when tan theta is small, it means theta is small. So sine theta becomes approximately equal to tan theta, and cos theta becomes approximately equal to 1 for a small angle. So 11.3 degrees is still a relatively small angle. So this makes the calculation a bit easier to handle. People, so I hope this is clear to all of you. Can you explain the note for the smaller angle? Yeah, I'll explain that. Finish writing down this part, then I'll explain the small angle concept once more. Okay, so let's understand the small angle approximation once more. Small angle approximations. See, they work like this. If you look at the definition of angle itself, angle in radians, which is the SI unit, is defined as arc upon radius. So if this is an arc that we have cut using an angle or using a radius r, then theta is defined as the ratio of arc upon angle in radians. Whereas from this point, if we drop a perpendicular, then this becomes a perpendicular, this becomes the base, and we define sine theta as perpendicular upon hypotenuse, cos theta as base upon hypotenuse, and tan theta as perpendicular upon base. Okay. Now just imagine the same diagram, but with a very small angle theta, comparatively small angle theta. When the angle theta is small, when you drop this perpendicular over here, the base is almost equal to the radius and the perpendicular is almost equal to the arc length. Therefore, theta becomes approximately equal to tan theta or sine theta. And cos theta comes approximately equal to 1. So I'll give you an example to understand this. So the example we had was tan theta was 0.2. Theta was tan inverse 0.2. So that's 1 by 5. So here we're talking about a situation where this perpendicular upon base is 1 by 5. Okay. So this arc length upon this radius will also be nearly 1 by 5. Because it's a small ratio. No? 1 by 5 is a small ratio. So we can prove that also. So if we were to draw a proper right angle triangle, which has this particular angle theta, okay, where tan theta is 1 by 5. That means if this side is x, this side should be 5x. Because perpendicular upon base should be equal to 1 by 5. So that means this side becomes how much? This side becomes x root 26 using Pythagoras theorem. So now you can see that for tan theta equal to 1 by 5, sine theta is x upon x root 26, which is 1 upon root 26, which is very nearly 1 by 5. And cos theta is 5x upon x root 26, which is 5 by root 26, which is again very nearly 1. So you can see that this is what is happening. When we are taking theta as tan inverse of 0.2, that means tan theta is a small value. So that means theta is small. That means we can use approximation that tan theta is approximately equal to sine theta and cos theta is approximately equal to 1. This is my small angle approximation. And same thing, if you use a scientific calculator or a sine cos tan table to work it out also, you'll see that it gives you the correct values. Using a calculator, if you see, tan inverse of 0.2 was approximately 11.3 degrees. Now, if you work out sine of 11.3 degrees, you'll see it comes out to be 0.1996. That's nearly 0.2. And if you work out cos of 11.3 degrees, you see it comes out to be 0.9982 something. So it's nearly 1. So even using exact values from a calculator will justify the small angle approximation that you've done. So, yeah, that is the approximation that is there in the second diagram. The base becomes approximately equal to R. See what is happening in the second diagram. The arc is so small that when we cut the perpendicular, it hardly cuts any different length. The base is nearly equal to the radius. Understanding this base length from here to here is nearly equal to the radius because there's hardly any difference between the arc and the perpendicular. Why? Because this angle is very small. The key thing here is that this angle is small. So when this is happening, the base is nearly equal to the radius. And the perpendicular is nearly equal to the arc itself. Okay. So accordingly, you can see that your tan theta, which is perpendicular upon base, and sine theta, which is perpendicular upon hypotenuse, they are nearly same. Okay. And cos theta, which is base upon hypotenuse, is nearly equal to 1. Yeah, they're nearly equal. You see the difference between the two triangles. Now, one has a comparatively larger value of theta. So there's a lot of difference between the perpendicular length and the arc length. There's a lot of difference between the radius, which is this full length, and the base. But now imagine you're gradually reducing this angle theta. So the difference between these values starts to become very less. So by the time theta is very small, like in this diagram, there's hardly any difference between the base and the radius. Okay? And hardly any difference between perpendicular and the arc length. So you must have seen these approximations in trigonometry also. So this is how the approximations can be understood geometrically. Small angle approximation is something important in your trigonometry chapter in maths also. So you should know how to do this. And this is the logic of the small angle approximation. So hope this is clear. Okay, very good. So we are done with the conceptual part of circular motion. Now we will come to the next part, which will be vertical circular motion. But let us understand one example question today. So any circular motion happening in a vertical plane is called vertical circular motion. So suppose we have a situation like this where we have a smooth hemispherical hill kind of thing. So this is a smooth hemispherical surface of radius r. Now there's a particle sitting over here at the top and it's given a slight push. So its velocity is almost tending to zero. But as a result of that push, it comes sliding down. So by the time it comes to an angle theta, It has picked up some non-zero kind of velocity. So given that the radius of this is 20 meters, g is equal to 10 meters per second square. Now the particle p initially at the top is given a slight push, u tending to zero almost, as shown. So we have to find its speed v, and the normal contact force n at an instant when theta is equal to sine inverse of 1 by 30. Sorry, sine inverse of 5 by 30. So you have started with, you know the basics of work by energy, right, people? Have you done the work, basics of work energy theorem, right? So you know the concept of gravitational potential energy and all that. So here you will have to apply that concept. You'll have to apply the idea that as the particle slides down the hemispherical surface, okay, work done by normal reaction will be how much? Can you tell me how much will be work done by normal reaction force? At any instant, normal reaction ka direction kaisa hai? It is acting perpendicular to the surface. Whereas what about the instantaneous velocity? It is tangential to the surface. So work done by any force is integration of F dot ds. And the direction of displacement is always along the direction of velocity. Right, this concept you know, right? Work done in general is defined like this. So here at any point of time, the work done by normal reaction will be how much? It will be zero. Because wherever the particle is, the direction of normal reaction and the direction of the velocity, very good. The dot product will give us zero now. So here you can see that this will be zero because that's correct. Because normal reaction is perpendicular to the velocity at any instant. So therefore n dot ds is zero always. So therefore work done by normal reaction is going to be zero. So now because work done by normal reaction is zero, plus there is no friction. On the surface. So therefore what is happening? Mechanical energy will be conserved. change in kinetic energy plus change in gravitational potential energy would be zero. So as the particle is sliding from this position here, let's call this position A, to this position here B, its speed is changing from about zero to some V, but also it is going through a height difference of H. So the particle's mass is M, the change in kinetic energy is plus half mv squared, but the change in potential energy is minus mgh, so that should be zero. So V should be equal to root 2gh. Now thing is, we have to find H when theta is equal to sine inverse of pi by 13. So that we see is very easy. That's just about geometry. You can see this is R, and from here you just drop a perpendicular. So this is the edge that we're looking for. Whereas here you can see this is the base of this triangle. So the base is equal to how much? Base upon R is cos theta. So the base is R cos theta. Okay. So the height becomes how much? It becomes R minus that base. So it becomes R minus R cos theta. Okay. Now sine theta is pi by 13. That means cos theta is square by 13. You can check this out, because sine square theta plus cos square theta should be 1. Next step, we can see that cos theta is 12 by 13. That means H will be R by 13. So the speed and then you substitute the values here. Radius, I think, was 20 meters. So it's square root of 2 by 13 into 10 into 20. So 40 by 13 meters per second. That will become this. Okay, so this is an example of application of work power energy concept or conservation of mechanical energy in a vertical circular motion. Now this is what we'll concentrate on in the next lecture, and that is the last part of circular motion, which is vertical circular motion. In H.C. Verma, vertical circular motion problems are given at the end of the work power energy chapter, not in the circular motion chapter. So you can also go ahead and complete problems from H.C. Verma. There are a lot of problems on banking angle of the road and centrifugal force in non-inertial frame and all that. So you can finish those first. And then you can come to the vertical circular motion part, which is there in the work power energy chapter. And that, of course, we'll be discussing more of in the next lecture. So that is it for today's session, people. Wish you all the best. Make sure you revise all these three sessions, the fourth, fifth, and sixth, very carefully. Because we've seen some complicated concepts which we'll be using a lot in the next few lectures. So that's it for today, people. Wish you all the best.